It's so good to see so many of you here in church. I've done the elbow welcome to you all, and it's good to see you nicely spaced out. Welcome. We're also glad that we're joined by people who are live streaming, or we're live streaming to them, so welcome to wherever you are watching us today. It's good to have you too. We've been a bit lonely here for the last couple of weeks, just a few of us playing and preaching, but we're glad to have more of you here today. Welcome. Great to see you. We're so glad also to have our wonderful choir, our scratch choir, that's been put together over the last few weeks, and we're going to hear from them later. Thank you so much for coming and sharing with us in our worship today. Well, we live in extraordinary times, and we're living through extraordinary times. As we begin to give thanks to God for our recovery as a community, we are very conscious, of course, that many other communities are just beginning to feel the impact of this virus. So we remember them. We remember our global community today and all those who are facing what we have gone through and still, in a way, going through. So we pray for God's protection and care and love. It's been a challenge to us these last few months, not just with the virus, but with the protest movement and social upheaval. How do we hold on to faith in and through all of this? We're going to think about that today because we're going to Mount Sinai. That's our reading for today, the meeting place with God. How appropriate for us to come to the mountain of God and to hear what God has to say to us. I'm going to hear some words from Isaiah chapter 40 to encourage us. Isaiah 40, verses 27. As our call to worship, "Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord will renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall walk and not be faint." Those who wait on the Lord. We come to wait on the Lord today. We set this time aside to worship God, to wait upon him, and to listen to what he has to say to us. So as we come together, let's worship him in songs of praise. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord.
Shall we all stand? Shall we all stand and worship our God? Strength will rise.
oh God, you leave us on wings like eagles, and you are our everlasting God. Lord, we will wait upon you with strength. We will wait upon you. There are often times in these times, oh Lord, this hard season can often leave us feeling dry, hopeless, and defeated, and seems like we can no longer see the light at the end of the tunnel. But as you see, your people here are full of joy, Lord. We are full of joy. And it's just surprising because even in these times, we have this joy. Because we know that we have a Lord that will lift us up like eagles, O God. In you there is hope, in you there is peace, and in you there is real joy. And we confess our need for you today, O God. Fill our lives. Lord, reign in us. Reign in our family. Reign in our church. Lord, we need you this time. Come, come and reign in us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Father, this is our prayer that you would reign in our lives again. Reign over our dreams. Reign in our darkest hour. May we know that you are sovereign God over all things. And all things are held in your hands, secure. And you are a faithful God who never leaves us nor forsakes us, but walks with us and leads us through to that place of hopefulness and joy. Father, thank you that you carry us on the wings of eagles. You restore our youth. You restore our strength. So may this time of worshipping you be such a time of meeting with you and hearing your voice and finding strength in you. God, come and renew our strength today. Come and renew our hope. Come and renew us as your people, the people of God, a holy nation, a royal priesthood, no less. A treasured possession. So when we leave this place, may we leave with confidence. Confidence in you. You will accomplish your will in our lives and in this place. So we pray this prayer in the precious and holy name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And we say the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For thy kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Please do be seated. We don't have any video notices this morning, but I do want to extend a very warm welcome to you all. Dare I ask if anybody's new and here for the first time? That would be extraordinary and amazing and wonderful, but just our regulars have come back. It's good. Great to see you all. Despite this viral situation and our separation, things in church have continued. We've continued to have meetings through the wonderful Zoom and the Bible studies and disciple Bible study. And actually, I've probably got more out of those than I imagined I would, and felt a kind of intimacy with people because they were all in their homes and I was talking to them in their homes. And we had some interesting times. Eva bringing Eric a cup of tea, somebody else bringing a dog in, but all good fun. So church has continued, and we thank God for the wonderful technology that we're able. Though we can't meet together physically, we can meet together in other ways. And the church will gradually reopen. We will obviously keep an eye on what's happening outside day by day. And we'll see how things go as public buildings have opened this week, some of them, and some churches are returning. We hope that won't start anything new off. But do keep watching the website and our Facebook site. We post lots of things on there at the moment, so do keep an eye on that week, day by day, or certainly week by week. So it's good to see you. We welcome you back. This is the fourth week. We actually go to now have an offering the first time in a month. So the shields will wait amongst you for your offering. We give you thanks for your faithfulness throughout this time. We praise you and worship you. Accept now the offering that we give to you, that you might take it and bless it and use it to share the good news of Jesus Christ with our community and with the wider world. And we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. So, in the third week of our new series, God the Father, King, and today we reach Mount Sinai, place of meeting with God, with trembling and clouds of smoke. Here, the people will receive the law. And so we're going to first listen to the people gathering at the base of Mount Sinai, and then the choir will lead us. So, Marianne is going to read for us.
Exodus 19, 1 to 13. On the third new moon after the Israelites had gone out of the land of Egypt, on that very day, they came into the wilderness of Sinai. They had journeyed from Rephidim, entered the wilderness of Sinai, and camped in the wilderness. Israel camped there in front of the mountain. Then Moses went up to God. The Lord called to him from the mountain, saying, "Thus You shall say to the house of Jacob and tell the Israelites, You have seen what I did to the Egyptians and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now therefore, if you obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession out of all the peoples. Indeed, the whole earth is mine. But you shall be for me a priestly kingdom and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the Israelites. So Moses came, summoned the elders of the people, and set before them all these words that the Lord had commanded him. The people all answered as one, Everything that the Lord has spoken, we will do. Moses reported the words of the people to the Lord. Then the Lord said to Moses, I am going to come to you in a dense cloud, in order that the people may hear when I speak with you and so trust you ever after. When Moses had told the words of the people to the Lord said to Moses, Go to the people and consecrate them today and tomorrow. Have them wash their clothes and prepare for the third day, because on the third day the Lord will come down upon Mount Sinai in the sight of all the people. You shall set limits for the people all around, saying, Be careful not to go up the mountain or to touch the edge of it. Any who touch the mountain shall be put to death. No hand shall touch them, but they shall be stoned or shot with arrows. Whether animal or human being, they shall not live. When the trumpet sounds a long blast, they may go up on the mountain.
Exodus 20, verse 1 to 17. Then God spoke all these words. I am the Lord, your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord, your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of parents to the third or the fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you, your son or your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, but rested the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or an ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. This is the word of the Lord.
Let's pray together. God, we hear the great call to the Israelites to consecrate themselves, to separate themselves, for they were entering into the presence of a holy God, an awesome God. And we too dare to come to you today in this place. We dare to expect to meet with you. But in your holiness and greatness, you have given us the Lord Jesus Christ. And through him, our sins can be forgiven and we can be set apart. We can be holy. We can be made clean and right before you. So God, as you speak to us today, may you speak to our hearts about how we should consecrate ourselves, how we should try to live up to those laws and commands that you've given us, but above all, the greatest, to love. So speak through these scriptures, we pray. And we ask it in Christ's precious and holy name. Amen. Amen. Well, it's really good to see you. It's been an extraordinary 3 weeks here in church. Myself, Ray, and Ross have been the preachers, preaching to a virtually empty church. So for me, it was rather like being back in the UK, which is generally empty churches. And in fact, we had about 20 people live streaming and musicians. So some, that was actually a bigger congregation than some of the churches I've preached in the UK. But there we go. It's good to see more of you here today. It's interesting watching these American live chat show hosts in the evening, now no longer able to have a studio audience. And it's very different, you know, getting the feedback from people, the response, the laughter, the clapping. Not that you clap me, but I mean, you know, sometimes it's laughter. But it's very, thank you. But it's very different. It's very different. So it's good to see so many of you here today. Thank you for coming. Well, how appropriate today, the day on which we reopen the church and gather for worship, and think about in our new preaching series to be thinking about Mount Sinai, the great meeting place with God, the place where the Israelites have come after their long, arduous, frustrating at times, and tumultuous journey from bondage and slavery in Egypt. A journey of 3 months, three new moons we heard read, and almost 400 kilometers from Egypt to Sinai. It certainly hadn't been an easy journey for them. The honeymoon feeling of being set free is soon replaced with worries about basic necessities for them, food and water. For many of us living in Hong Kong, we too might feel like we've had a rather tumultuous journey these past few months, that we've experienced bondage and being captured or trapped because of the coronavirus, of not being able to go out or be together. We've experienced stuff through the social upheaval that we've experienced as well over those many months. Street battles and destruction of property, businesses closing down, and so much uncertainty in life. We've seen panic buying, schools and public buildings closed, flights cancelled in and out of the Hong Kong and now across the world. Our freedom severely restricted and curtailed. And of course, as we recover in Hong Kong, as I said at the beginning, we are so very mindful that the virus is only just now impacting other nations, that its center is no longer China but Italy. And as an international community church, we now have real concerns for our family members living in some of those places. We are connected globally. Absolutely, our faith has been tested and is being tested just as the Israelite faith was tested too. We too, like many of the Israelites, might have times have cried out to God. I know we have because you've told me. Where are you, God? Why have you left us here? Some of the Israelites also on their journey cried out to Moses to complain. Some of them even wanted to go back to Egypt, back to bondage and back to slavery, rather than to trust God for the present and for the future. But that's not what God wanted for them, and it's not what God wants for us. No going back, only forward into all that God is opening up for us. And sometimes the journey is through rocky places and tough places. But that's not the time to give up. That's the time to buckle down and trust in God. So how many of us would love a Mount Sinai experience today? Sounds a bit like a Disneyland ride, but there we go. A Sinai experience today. Coming to the Mount of God to hear God's voice, to experience God's presence with us, to be reminded He hasn't left us. He's not ignoring us. He's not silent. He's fully with us in the present situation. Things might look chaotic, out of control even. It might seem as if God is nowhere to be seen, but in fact the very reverse is true. God is an ever-present reality. He will not let your foot slip. Every hair of your head is numbered. He knitted you together in your mother's womb. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. God knows the words you speak before you speak them, the thoughts you have before you think them. He will not leave you. He will not run away from you. And Ross, in his terrific sermon last week, reminded us that sometimes blessing and curse are side by side. And out of our suffering, we can know God's blessing. So let me assure you that though I absolutely and firmly believe that God does not send suffering upon us, God does not lead us into temptation, does not cause viruses or political, social or personal upheavals, God sure can act and speak powerfully through them if we are listening. So gather round, because the King is here. And let's listen to what our Father will say to us today. What can we learn from this episode at Mount Sinai, which happened, you know, well over 1,000 years before the birth of Jesus? What does it have to say to us now in the 21st century? Three R's: reminder, relationship, and response. Reminder, relationship, and response. The reminder of what God has done. The relationship which exists with God, and the expected response of God's people in praise and obedience. So firstly, the reminder of what God has done. When times are tough, faith is tested, and God seems perhaps especially quiet. Over and over again, when these things happen, the Bible tells us to remember. To remember how God worked in the past. Remember how He saved, moved mountains, achieved the seemingly impossible, healed, restored, forgave. When we go through times of struggle and suffering, and God seems quiet, then we are to remember. God had released the Israelites from slavery and brought them out of hardship and suffering by the power of His outstretched arm. God had accomplished what was humanly impossible, the release of well over 1 million Israelites from slavery under the oppression of Egypt and the Pharaoh, although Pharaoh's army said it was only 100,000. He led them through 400 miles of wilderness, even through the Red Sea, and He brought to a watery end Pharaoh's armies and chariots. It was all God's doing. And God tells Moses, go tell the people to remember all of that. When they're moaning, when they think, God, I've left them, go and tell them to remember. They didn't do all those things. I did it. God had carried them on the wings of eagles and done what? Brought them to Myself. I've been telling a few people about my retreat. Last week, I had a few days away to pray and to think and to reflect, and I took myself off. And it was as I arrived in this place and with my bags of books and materials and papers and everything that I was planning on doing, I set it all out and sat down in the chair. My mind was whizzing around with all sorts of things going on, things that I'd forgotten to do or needed to do or whatever. And as I sat wondering which book to start reading, which paper to start writing, which this or that or that, I saw a great bird, one of the black kites, fly in front of the window. And they're magnificent birds, very famous in Hong Kong over Victoria Harbour. You can see them outside my apartment. My dog loves to watch the birds flying by. She's mesmerized by them, as I was on this occasion. And I went to the window to look more closely at this huge bird of prey as it swooped and dived and soared. And as I stood and watched it, this magnificent, majestic bird, I noticed it wasn't flapping wildly. You know, it was just seemed to be hanging and gliding and floating in the air. And that's when God said to me, Eden, stop struggling and striving. You don't need a pile of books and a pile of papers or this or this or this. Just rest. The bird expanded its wings right out. That's what you need to do, Eden. Expand your wings, and then you'll catch the air, the Spirit, and the Spirit will lift you. The Spirit will enable you to soar, not your struggling and striving. God says, I carried them on the wings of eagles and brought them to Myself. We need to hear that in our lives and in our community. To rest in God. To allow God to hold us and carry us. We'll accomplish actually so much more. The bird didn't do very much, but caught the air pockets, and it was able to lift up. And it was so majestic to watch. So let's us expand our wings out too. Expand faith, relationship with God. And the more you do, the more you will soar with God. Remember all these things. All that I did for you, says God to Moses to tell the people. How I brought them out. How I've led them this far. I will not now leave them. When you look back now, can you see the hand of God at work in your life? Do you remember the times when God felt so close you could touch him? His voice so clear you could do nothing but follow? Miracles happened and mountains were moved. Can you not look back and remember times when doors opened and new opportunities beckoned, lights came on in the dark and pathways were cleared? Can you not remember the feeling of being set free, experiencing such grace as only God could bestow, delight as only God could impart? And if you can't, then you're possibly the bird flapping furiously with your wings. And the other way for that bird is down eventually. That's not what God wants for you. He wants to carry you to himself on wings of eagles. Are you trapped in something you feel you cannot escape from, enslaved by its snare, like an animal caught in a trap? That's not what God wants for you either. He wants you to be free. He wants you to know freedom in Christ. I am thankful that I can look back. And I need to be reminded sometimes to look back and to see God's hand upon my life. I remember as if it was yesterday, the evening I got saved or gave my life to Christ or became a Christian. I remember the strong, almost overwhelming sense of the presence of God at the Billy Graham mission and rally, as well as in my study room in 1986. God could work in stadiums. God can work in your room. I remember the miracles of wonder, the moments of sheer joy at God's doing, and the moments of sheer terror turned into delight. And I know what I once was, and what God has enabled me to become, and that I still have a very long way to go to become more like Christ. It's a journey, you see. So I look back, and I'm thankful to see the extraordinary and intricately laid out path of my life. A different decision, and I would have missed something or someone. Too soon, and it wouldn't have worked out. Too late, and it would have been a disaster. Looking back leaves me breathless at God's amazing leading. And the thing is, if that's how it's been for all these years, why would God suddenly change now? Why would, after being a totally faithful God for all this time, would God suddenly give up and walk away? That's not our God. God doesn't do that. He won't. My life in him is as secure now as it has ever been. And yours is too. The world around us may be tough at times. My life might have its ups and downs and challenges. But God remains the same. Faithful, true, and strong for you. If you're not seeing the wonderful works and miracles of God, maybe it's time to stop and ask yourselves, do I really know God? Have I ever really given my life to Christ? Have I ever really come to the cross and confessed my sins and my waywardness and my need of God's grace and forgiveness in Christ? Or have I built my life upon the sand, the things of this world? Money, kids, education, success, career, home, insurance schemes, and status and hierarchy. They're not things that will be solid for you when life becomes more challenging. They're shifting sands. So as I stand here at Sinai, the meeting place of God, surrounded with all the saints in light, I've just seen what God has done. And I know that I can trust him for the present and for the future. So remind yourselves today. Oh yeah, God did that. I remember that moment. I remember that time as if it was yesterday. Reminder. Secondly, the relationship which exists with God. So the relationship which God our Father really desires with you is one that shines a light into the world and reflects his glory out into the world. I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. What an absolutely wonderful phrase. And if you remember nothing else from this sermon, remember that. I brought you to myself. These words really have come to me powerfully in this sermon. Notice what God doesn't say. I did all this to bring you into the promised land. No. I saved you from one land to take you to another. No. I saved you from oppression and slavery to free you into Canaan, the promised land. No. But I did all of this to bring you to myself, to bring you into a relationship with me, that you might know me and love me as I love you. And God did not say to any of you, I saved you so that you could serve in the church. I saved you so you could attend Bible studies and fellowship meetings and worship services and committees. I saved you so you can have a happy, carefree life. I saved you so you can be rich and successful. No. I did all these things for you to bring you to myself, to bring you into relationship with me first and foremost. Carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. I'm bringing us to God that we might know his love and know that we are his treasured possession, a holy nation, a royal priesthood, not just a priesthood, but a royal priesthood, priests to the king. You know, Westminster Abbey in London is called a royal peculiar, because the Queen is the head, the sovereign is the head of that abbey. She's the boss. And if you're a chaplain, a priest to the Queen, you can wear a red cassock. And if any archbishops or bishops come to preach or to lead services, a letter is taken to them and read to them and told to them, you have no jurisdiction in this abbey. The priests are the Queen's priests. And the abbey is the Queen's. So you can come, but don't have any authority. We are not ordinary priests. We are royal priests, set apart, consecrated, holy. What do priests do? They represent God, the King, to the people, and the people to God. And that's part of who we are. That's part of our relationship with God, as we come into a relationship with him. The people of God will be set apart, a light to all the other nations to show the way. And Peter picks this up in his first letter. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness and into his wonderful light. This is our life. This is our call. God has acted mightily to bring us his treasured possession to himself. That we might become holy, a holy nation, a royal priesthood, to declare his praises to the nations. What a time to be called up to be priests and holy people. What a calling and a responsibility is ours. My goodness, how do we do it? Through such times of struggle and suffering. Well, let me tell you, there has never been a more important time in Hong Kong. Never a more critical moment than now to rise up to this challenge of holiness. A time to represent God, to stand in the place of God and be his very presence in and for our community, which is in such need and anxiety, sickness and suffering. Now is the moment, this is the time, to shine like lights. Now is the time to cast off apathy and weariness and sadness and misery. Now is the time to stop being lukewarm. And we know what Jesus says of lukewarm people. I vomit you out of my mouth. Now is the time to put away laziness and thinking this is the time to be laid back and relaxed and enjoy myself. No. No. Now is the time to be the people God has called us to be. A royal priesthood. A holy nation. A people who declare the praises of him who led us out of darkness into his wonderful light. Don't fritter light away in your life. Share it. Shine with it. So a reminder. Relationship. And finally, what's the response? Response of God's people in obedience and praise. The people have been given such a very high calling. Holiness, priesthood, how are they to achieve such a high calling? Well, it was at Sinai that they would receive the law, the commands, which, if followed, would bring them and keep them in that right relationship with God. The first part of the commandments, five of them, are directly related to our relationship with God. It's uppermost, it's primary. One God, worship Him alone, no other false gods, no idols. The name of God must never be taken in vain, and we must set aside proper time for the worship of this God, of our God. How's that all going for you, for me? How central is God in your life today? How much time do you give to God in your week? Try something. Sit down and write it down. Everything you do with your time. And see where God fits in to that time. How much time do you give to Him? Sadly, all too often when hardship comes, suffering knocks at the door, we're quick to turn away from God and panic as we search around for human solutions and answers to the problem. We must stay close to God. Worship, scripture, fellowship, prayer. So the first part of the law, our relationship with God. And then to the community, our relationship with each other. Firstly, families. Such importance in society. Good, strong families. The bedrock of a good, successful society. And then to the wider community. Do not murder. Do not commit adultery. No stealing. No false witness. No coveting. The laws for an obedient community. Laws which will enable the community to flourish, allowing the people of God to become holy, set apart, righteous, to shine as a light for all the nations. The problem was that despite God's faithfulness, despite God carrying the people on wings of eagles to Himself, despite the call to holiness and priesthood, the people failed. Even before the law could be given, the people had made for themselves a golden calf and worshipped it. And oh, how true this is so often for our own lives. We all too quickly replace God with something golden, something to be admired, gazed upon, delighted in, an idol. And we spend so much more time with that idol than with God. That idol seems to bring excitement and joy, pleasure and delight. But it cannot save us when hard times come. It does not bear us up on wings of eagles. So do not make for yourselves idols. Give God His proper place. One of the things, many things that we have learnt through our present troubles is the need, our need for each other, of community, whether that be local, national or international. We can't close borders. We can't act unilaterally. We can't stop people and keep them out. We need to communicate with each other. We need to work together. We see that today more than ever. And God knows that. And that's why the laws are as they are for the new community that He was creating in the Promised Land. God, family, community. The law could not save. Before they received the law, they built the golden calf and angered God. Moses smashed it up, melted it down. We too build our golden calves. We need to break them down, smash them. And turn again to God. But even after receiving the law, they couldn't keep it. They couldn't live up to it. And so we were given the wonderful gift of Jesus Christ. God came Himself in Christ, not to nullify the law, but to make it live, to make it work. That you and I here in the 21st century might know that we are being carried on the wings of eagles, being carried to God, being made alive in Christ, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a treasured possession, made possible through the blood of Christ shed upon the cross for you and for me. Christ makes the law work for us. And when we fail, and when we break the commands, and when we build golden calves, we can come again to Christ and to the cross and say, "Forgive me." And God, in His holiness and forgiveness and love, restores you. So rid yourselves of golden calves. They cannot save you and only make God angry. And turn again to God in Christ. Remember, through times particularly of suffering and hardship, remember what God has done in the past and trust Him again for the present and for the future. The relationship that God has called us into, we are treasured possessions. We are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a light to all the other nations. And we'll only be able to do that when we stay close with God, following the laws and the commandments made possible through the blood of Christ offered on the cross. So come again to the cross. Find your forgiveness. Find a new start. And find your hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's pray for a minute, and then we're going to sing. Father, we do thank you for this amazing call upon our lives. We see it all those years ago as the Israelites gathered at Mount Sinai. That all that you had done for them to lead them out of bondage and slavery, leading them through the wilderness to this point. And there you met them on the mountain. God, I pray that you would lead us out of all that binds us, all that holds us captive and slaves. Set us free. Break those bonds. Help us to become again all that you desire us to be. Your treasured possession, holy nation, royal priesthood, people belonging to you to declare your praises. So we come again to the cross of Christ, which makes all of this possible. We lay down all the burdens. We offer to you that golden calf and say, sorry, God. We know it can't save us. May we instead find our strength, our delight, and our joy in you, our God. And may we work together to build good, strong communities of faith. Especially in here in Hong Kong at this time, but throughout the world. For you are indeed calling us. So we're going to sing as we remain seated. This beautiful song, You Are Calling Us.
Calling us, so we are gathered here. You're building us into a house of prayer.
A holy place.
A holy place where sorry or praise are told. A sacred space where miracles unfold. Is right from the offering of our life. Let's fill this house. Let's fill this house. Call the seeker, call the stranger, call the children. Let's I
Moment, we will have our intercessory prayer. So wherever you are, please join me in prayer. Shall we all pray? In the ancient days, Jesus Christ, you traveled from place to place to heal diseases that seems impossible to cure. At your touch and command, sick people were restored. In this present time, as we face this pandemic brought by coronavirus, come to our aid, that we may experience your healing touch. Jehovah Rapha, God who heals, heal those who are sick with the virus, comfort those who are bereaved, and strengthen those who are working to fight the virus. During the storm, when your disciples were so afraid, you got up and rebuked the wind and the waves. In these present times, many of us have fears and doubts. Speak to us and make us still and calm. May we always be reminded that there's nothing to be fear of when you are at our side. Jehovah Shalom, Lord of Peace, heal us from our fear, which prevents us from working together and helping each other. We remember all the students and workers who are studying abroad that are affected. Make a way for them to be at peace. During the feeding of the 5,000, Jesus, you made a miracle to provide for the needs of thousands of people. In this time, a lot of businesses are shutting down. Massive number of workers are losing job. Our leaders are needing wisdom. We need your provision in many ways. Jehovah Yireh, God our provider, provide wisdom to our government and church leaders, that they may invest in long-term solutions that will help prepare future outbreaks. Provide for those who don't have the means to buy the basic needs, masks and sanitizers. Provide for those who are affected with economic turmoil, and provide answers to our scientists who make ways to create vaccines. During the encounter with the woman at the well, Jesus, you were able to see what the Samaritan woman is going through without her opening up to you. At this moment, a lot of us may have difficulty to come in your presence. We are stopped by our negative emotions like fears, doubts, or whatever it is. Jehovah Elroy, the God who sees all, evaluate our hearts and purify us so we may come in your presence and experience you in this time. Jehovah Shammah, as your name says, we acknowledge your presence in the midst of us. You have showed your power before through Jesus Christ our Lord. You are faithful, and you are the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. In Jesus' name, amen.
So we end with a hymn that reminds us of the greatness and the majesty and the power of God, immortal, invisible, God only wise. Let's stand and sing together.
Thank you.
God, may we never take you for granted. May we remember these great stories. Be reminded of the way that you met your people with power, trembling, holiness. Do not come too close. And yet you have made a way for us to know you through the cross of Christ. But Lord, may we never take this for advantage of. May we never take it for granted. You are a holy God, and you call us to be a holy people. So help us to renew ourselves in your spirit, to soar on the wings of eagles, to be carried to you, and there to find our transformation, to become a holy nation, a royal priesthood, a treasured possession. To burn those golden calves and shifting sands that we have built our lives upon, that we might know the solid rock and foundation is only in Jesus Christ. And to him be all praise and glory today. And now may the blessing of God, God the Father, and God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, rest and remain with each one of you, and with all whom you love, wherever they may be, now and forever. Amen. Please sit as the choir leads us in a blessing.
Thank you.
Thank you.